Welcome to Metro Tab. Thank you for sharing these life moments with us. We are a diverse and dynamic family that places strong emphasis on building bridges and equipping people to find their purpose. Here you will find relevant teaching, heartfelt worship, and relationship. You can find a home here at Metro Tab. So we say, welcome home. We also want to welcome our online viewers who have logged on to MetroTab.net from around the world. We are creating a culture of generosity. At MetroTab, you will find family. We walk in unity. Acceptance, because we are forgiven. Worship, it's a lifestyle. Excellence, it's our choice. Diversity, we celebrate each other. Life is better when you live in community. We would love for you to connect to the life-shaping ministries of Metro Tab. Life is all about relationship. We are doing life together. Whether you are a guest or already part of the Metro Tab family, please take a moment to fill out the connection card located in the service guide or the seat in front of you. You can submit connection cards when the offering is received. Stop by the Connection Center for more information and a complimentary CD of our service. Thank you.
Metro Tab. please rise for the singing of our national anthem.
Metro Tab, come on, let's celebrate freedom in this place. Are you ready? Let's go. Hopes and dreams. say.
Service. When it comes to setting yourself free, the first step is you need to discover your worth.
Amen.
Yes. If you don't know your worth, then you will be content to live in bondage.
Right.
You'll be content to just believe what others say about you.
Come on.
And you'll live your life as a victim. But when you discover your worth, everything changes. See, a lot of times we're guilty of looking through a negative lens. You know, I'm too this, I'm too that. I'm too old, I'm too young, I'm too clumsy. You know, I never was the kid picked, you know, in the popular crowd. I never fit in, too short, too tall, too something. We find ourselves using the words, I can't. You need to erase I can't out of your vocabulary when it comes to saying what you can't do. Unless you're going to say, I can't tolerate where I am, and I can't live this way anymore, and I'm headed to a new place.
Yes.
So you need to discover your worth. In that process, you have to understand that God determines your worth by how much He loves you, not by how much you've messed up or how good you've been, but by how much He loves you. And that's pretty amazing. In John 3:16, the Bible tells us that He loved you so much that He gave His only Son so that if you believed in Him, you would not be lost, but you would have eternal life. So Tony is sitting here representing humanity and all of us. And oftentimes, even as born-again believers, as accepting Christ as our Savior, we find ourselves dealing with chains. Now, a lot of times our chains are not on our hands or our feet. Most of our chains start right here. What we've been told, who we are, who we're not, what we can be, what we can't be. And we put it through the filter of our mind. If we don't have the right filter, we find ourselves chained up. But Christ gave His life so we could be free. In Psalm 139, these verses tell us, "You knit me together in my mother's womb. Your workmanship is marvelous. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life, every day of your life was recorded in his book. Every moment of your life, every single moment, every single day of your life, he knew about before your mom ever knew that you were in her womb. He saw the end of your life and traced it all the way back to the beginning of your life. In that passage of scripture, it goes on to say, basically, in Genesis, the Bible says that the Spirit of God brooded over the earth. And what we came to know is the earth came into being. The same Spirit brooded over you in your mother's womb and watched every day of your formation. It hit me in first service. It was not in my study notes at all. But we're living in a day of, you know, all these early onset diseases. This is what you call early onset destiny. He knows everything about you. Here's a verse that's crazy to me. Luke 12:7. God even knows how many hairs you have on your head. You know, now I told him in first service, Tony keeps his hair cut pretty short. So that's a challenge. Like, if I had to count this boy's hair, like, wow. Now I could probably count some of mine. Some of you made it easy on God. He has to do less counting. Saves him, you know, more time for those people who have horses' manes for hair to keep up with theirs. Philippians 4:19 says, "My God will use his glorious riches to give you everything you need. He will do this through Christ Jesus." See, you had to discover your worth. If he thought you were worth enough to brood over you in your mother's womb and to lay your days out and fashion every one of your days, if he thinks you're worth enough of sending heaven's riches to you to take care of all your needs, that's some pretty high worth. Isaiah 55 verses 8 through 9 says this, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts." Can we just all go, phew? I know some days we got this. Then there are some other days, I'm so glad he's not up in my head thinking what I'm thinking. Could be dangerous. Part of that verse I didn't put on the screen says, as far as the heavens, as high as the heavens are above the earth, so are his thoughts higher than our thoughts. It goes on to say, my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm so glad he doesn't think like you. And don't say amen back in their faces. So here's a praise break for Tony, who represents all of us. See, he thought you were worth saving, sir.
He thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, so I could tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving. Come on, if you believe that, lift your hands and say, you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up.
So you cleaned me up. Inside.
You thought I was to die for. So you came and you changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. Oh, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. I'm so glad that he found me worthy. I'm so glad that he picked me up and set my feet on a rock. Hey! Somebody sing high.
Set yourself free. First step is discovering your worth. Once you discover your worth, you realize that there is power in speaking his word. See, when you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, the Bible says he embodies you. You are his temple. You are him in the flesh. You are to be his hands, his feet, his mouth, his eyes, his ears. In the earth realm. The Bible says that he became, where are you scholars? He became flesh, and the flesh became the Word. And for the Word to work in your life, according to Proverbs, you're going to have to speak it. Proverbs says death and life are in the power of your mouth. Some days we need to just shut it up. But not today. We're going to speak His word. Now, Jason is here representing the fact that we've given our heart to Christ. But the truth is, there are moments in our lives that we need to stop speaking death and start speaking life. And it happens very subtly. We say things that we don't weigh what we're saying. You know, because my daddy had it and his daddy had it. Well, I guess, go ahead and prophesy to yourself. You know, we say frivolous things like, that's killing me. That just kills me. Say, is it that serious? Maybe. See, when you get in a hospital situation, there's some folks you don't want to come visit you. I'm going to just tell you, if it ever happens in my life, you better put a barricade on the door. And if I die, I will die declaring His word. And I don't want anybody else around me in the halls or riding in my car or hanging out at my house speaking nothing but His word. Nothing but. So let's do that together. I haven't put the actual scriptures on here, but I suggest you write these locations down and kind of chew on them this week. I've just put some declarations on the screen for us. Let's say this together. According to Job 22, 28, the Bible says, I can
declare a thing and it will be established for me.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
See, you need to get an attitude. And if you don't have one, that's why God brought you to Metro Tab. Most of us have one. Don't matter our skin color. Most of us got one around here. Most of us have learned how to tell the devil and all of his junk to go back to hell where you came from. You have to learn to remind him of his future. His future is not with me. Let's keep declaring. According to Mark 11, 23, I can speak to the mountain
in my life and it has to move. If I do not doubt in my heart and believe his word, I will have whatever I say.
You begin to speak and your chains begin to fall off. Let's keep speaking. According to Isaiah 53, 5, Christ was wounded for my sins. He was bruised for my wickedness. He gave his life so I could live free. By his stripes, I am healed. See, by his stripes, I'm just crazy enough to believe that you're healed physically, spiritually, emotionally, and financially. I want the entire benefit package. If you don't want all your benefits, just lay them down, so the rest of us are going to pick them up. Let's keep declaring. According to Psalm 118, 17, I will live to declare the works of the Lord. I can tell some of y'all are familiar with this declaration because you're shaking your heads in the back of this room. Let's keep warring. According to Deuteronomy 28, if I obey his word, he will command a blessing on my life. My children will walk under the commanded blessings of God. The Lord will defeat my enemies before my face. I will prosper in everything I do. you start digging around in that chapter, it will tell you the assignment against you will come as one big chunk of an assignment. But it will depart in parcels, in particles. The Bible says seven different places. It will break in seven. You know, you need to study your word. Seven is what? The number of completion. You need to get in your word. There's life in your word. Let's keep declaring. According to Psalm 27:1, the Lord is my light and my salvation. I do not walk in fear. I do not walk in anxiety. I do not walk in anxiousness because he is my light and he is my salvation. Let's keep declaring. According to Psalm 103, I will bless the Lord. I will bless his holy name. I will never forget his benefits. He forgives all of my iniquities. He heals all of my diseases. He redeems my life from destruction. He crowns me with tender mercies. He renews. See, I don't have time to get on that Steve Ball series about eagles and tell you that when he begins to renew you, he screeches over you from one eagle to another. I don't have time talking about the renewing process. We don't have time to go there. We'll be there till 3 o'clock this afternoon. Here's your praise break, Jason, because you represent all of us who are learning to speak his word. His word says, you are no longer a slave to sin. You are a child of God.
Unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Come on, do you believe it this morning? Church, do you believe it this morning? And from my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. And I've been born again into your family. Oh.
turn to somebody that you'd less like to say this to and just tell them, I have been diagnosed with early onset destiny. Declare a thing and it will be established for you. So when you discover your worth and you learn the power of speaking His word, you may still have to deal with your story. Anybody got a story in the house? Welcome to Metro Tab. As Pastor says, we all got a story. See, all of our life moments have brought us to this moment in time. And life happens. You understand that? Life happens to all of us. Once you push your way down through your entrance into this world, it's on, baby. In fact, some of it's on before you have come out. Because you're a victim to whatever that woman does. You know, whatever she eats. But we have all had victories and defeats and regrets and happiness. We've had gains and losses. We've had joy. We've had sadness. We've had frustration. We've had anger. Because life happens. In Psalm 3, verse 3, we read these incredible words. You, O Lord, are a shield for me. He shields us. You are my glory, regardless of my story. And you are the one who lifts my head. I didn't pitch it to this team on the spur of the moment, because it's a song that takes some practice. But there's no song I love better than the one that says, O Lord, thou art a shield for me, the glory and the lifter of my head. And I've learned in seasons of life, see, if you're honest with yourself, some seasons press you more than others. Not all seasons are the same, but there'll be some seasons in life where you don't really feel like declaring His word. There'll be moments. It may not be weeks, it may not be months. But I've had some of those moments, and even when I know to declare His word, you ever have a moment you just wonder, does it even really work? You ever anybody honest enough to just say, I've just wondered a time or two, does this stuff even work? But in those moments when you're pressed and you find yourself on the floor, physically, spiritually, financially. In those moments, I have found this Holy Spirit, without me even asking, will just begin to lift my countenance. See, it's what you call walking in covenant. If you're in covenant with someone, then you know them. And you know what they need before they even ask. And if we can do that as humans, how much more does our Heavenly Father, who counts the hairs on our head, He's that interested in the details of our lives, how much more? See, when we are at our weakest, the Bible says He is the strongest. So when you feel that life has flattened you and all the air is out of your life and all the life tread is off of your tires and your steel is just hitting concrete, I dare you to remember Psalm 3:3. Because if you're walking with Him, He will lift your head. He is the lifter. See, Deuteronomy 7, verse 9 says, He is the faithful God who keeps His covenant for 1,000 generations. It doesn't matter what your story has looked like, what you were born into, the choices you made. No matter how dark you think it was, how distressed, maybe how demented. This scripture says, if you draw a line and you declare him as the Lord of Lords and King of Kings, then you can change the legacy for those who walk behind you. And your choices today can change it for 1,000 generations. That's power. That's authority. That's favor. Hebrews 12 verses 1 through 2 says, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. There are witnesses in this room to his glory. There are witnesses around the globe. There are those of us who have lost saints that have gone on before us. Now, I'm not one of those that believe they can see us out of heaven. Maybe that, if that's you, that's fine. You believe what you want to believe. But my Bible tells me there's no tears in heaven and no sorrow. So if they're able to see, you know, I would love to think that my Father is watching what I'm doing. But what I have learned from his teaching and from experience of watching a saint on their deathbed, I've been in the room. My dad had a vision several days before his departure from this earth. And he began to tell me and my sister, do you see them? Who, Dad? I see my dad. I see my mom. I see my uncle. They're telling me to come on. Amen. See, I heard my aunt Arlene describe my grandmother's passing, and she saw a light in the corner of her room, and she said, Arlene, there's a light. Do you see it? No, Mom, I don't see it. See, when you're in those moments, you'll be glad you don't see it, because if you start seeing it, it's time for you to go. Don't be discouraged that you hadn't seen angels and hadn't seen Jesus in flesh and hadn't seen big bright lights, because when you start seeing that stuff, you're headed out of here. So don't feel like you're less spiritual. I don't really want to see any lights right now. I just know they're there. But my grandmother saw that. I've seen saints of God. See, what I know about them is once they get to that point and they begin to see something that they've been singing about and teaching about and living about and telling their kids about, when they start seeing that thing and that love, that huge, bright light of love that they could not comprehend until that point, it is such a strong pull that no matter how much they love you, they'll just end up saying in their spirit, I love you, baby, but there's a place I've got to go. The lover of my soul is there. I am headed to spend eternity with him. But there's a cloud of witnesses that will beckon you across that finish line. You can look in the Bible and find those witnesses. In the balcony of life, there are people cheering your story on. This scripture says, lay aside every weight and sin which so easily traps us or ensnares us. Run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto him who is the author and the finisher of our faith. See, your story started with him brooding over you in your mother's womb. Wow. Wow. And none of your choices, none of your decisions messes him up. He's already seen the end. And he knows if you let him today start writing your story, he knows what the end is going to look like. See, there are those of you who sit here, you think, well, you don't know my story, Pastor Rita. It's not been a good story. See, there are folks who have been on death row here in religion. And you got up off of death row. There are those of you who had jail time. There are those who have been abused. There are those who have abused. We're all a family. This is a safe house for your story. To let your story evolve. But with all of that, with discovering our worth and speaking his word, if we're honest, sometimes we still struggle with self-condemnation. We know the choices we've made. It's a tool of the enemy. to beat you and make you feel less than. Like you don't fit. And he can't use you because of this and because of that. That is simply a lie. It's simply a lie. So we founded this house many years ago. I was in a public business yesterday, and a lady, I had on some cross earrings or something, and she said, "I see your crosses. Where do you go to church?" I just really wanted to blow her mind and say, "What do you mean?" I just have too much meanness in me sometimes. I'm like, "You assume?" You know. I said, "My husband and I are lead pastors at the Metro Tab Church." She said, "Where is that?" I said, "On 153. She said, "I pass that building every day that I go to work." And she said, "What caused you and your husband to start a church in Chattanooga?" I'm thinking, you don't have time for the story. And I just basically said, I said, "Well, we've been pastors for a long time." And I said, "Lived here many, many years ago, and he always had a vision for this city, so we came back and did what we were supposed to have done a long time ago." She said, "So tell me about your church." I said, "Well, it's pretty diverse." I said, "We kind of like it that way. We're diverse intentionally." She said, "So you defy the boundaries of Chattanooga." Man. I said, "Yes, that's exactly what we do." I'm like, couldn't have said it better myself. Yes. Like, yes, this is what we do. She said, she's got this look. She said, "I need to." I said, "Yeah, you do. You do." I said, "Let me know when you come." I said, "I'll be on the front row. You can find me." But with all of that, there are still moments in all of our lives that we feel less than. We see people on, you know, a ministry stage and think, well, none of them have anything in their life like mine. They're all just the kids next door, made perfect decisions with perfect parents and perfect homes. No, not so much. Not so much. You may be like Ben, who sits here today, in church, in a worship experience, but he's got chains. Chains of doubt, chains of fear, chains of they don't really know my story. Could God ever use me? Yeah, Ben, I want to say to you, as you stand in proxy for all of those people who feel that way, there will be a tabernacle that will shade you in the daytime from the heat. Yes. There is a place of refuge that will cover your life. There is a shelter that will shelter you from storm and from rain. I want to say to you, Ben, welcome home. And I want to say to you, baby, you may not feel worthy, but it is our desire to lead you and teach you about a Christ that will take you to another level in your life. And he will place you in a place of ministry because somebody needs to know your story. And I want to say to you, Ben, that when you see nothing but damaged goods, when you look in the mirror, he sees something good in the making. And when you see nothing but wounds and scars, he sees mended.
How many times can one heart break? It was never supposed to be this way. Look in the mirror, but you find someone you never thought you'd be. Stay nice.
About you. Why don't you praise him for what he says about you? Father, we thank you that you do not see what we see, but you see a creation fashioned by a creator to display your glory. God, I thank you that your thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Your ways are higher than our ways. And even in our mother's womb, you ordained us to display your glory. I thank you, Father. Because you're beyond description. You are the beginning of our life, and you'll be the ending of our life. It ends with an eternity with you. And in all of this meantime that we walk through, your word says you never leave us, you never forsake us. God, I thank you that you have given us the ability to discover our worth through your grace and your mercy. And when we speak your word, mountains move. And when we speak your word, we move. And today, we replace our story in your hands and say, use it for your glory. God, I committed my life to you a long time ago. But in this moment, on this Independence Weekend, we stand here in this setting, in this room, and I declare, I want you to be Lord of Lords and King of Kings in my life. I want you to be Lord of every situation, every decision, every relationship. Let your word be alive in me and in us, Father. We give our lives to you afresh and anew to let your glory put us on display, Father. Let this house be a billboard of your grace and mercy. To everyone that sees us, somebody is reading our story, Father. Let them see your glory in the lines of our story. In the strong name of Jesus. Father, this is Independence Weekend where America celebrates her freedom. We give to you our nation. It is a different day. But Father, we do not fret and we do not fear because we have read the last page and your word tells us we win. So we just say, Father, work your plan. Work your plan in America. Help us to be good citizens, not bashing. Not bashing. But serving faithfully in a free nation as Christians who walk according to the word of God, knowing that you are our King, you are our Creator, and you are the designer of all of our days. So we ask you humbly, Father, to please bless America for the sake of our children. Bless America. Help us to continue to be a mighty moving force in the world. And as this thing winds up, Father, we will not fret. We will not fear. We will hold tightly to your word, knowing you are in control. Our destiny is in your hands. Before it gets too hot, we're out of here. So we have no worries. I bless you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. We're about to bring him our tithe and our offerings. I don't know of a better way to celebrate your freedom than to be financially free, spiritually free, emotionally free, and physically free. And the truth is, money means a lot to most of us, right? If you just be honest and say, it's okay, I like money, it's okay. I mean, try living without it. It's overrated. Overrated. But we bring him now 10% of our tithes, 10% of our income. Father, we submit this to you as a tool to be used in your kingdom. Your word says that if we walk according to your word and covenant, that you go to the edge of our world and you rebuke what's trying to devour our lives. Your word also says, and we prove you with this, that you open the windows of heaven over our lives I just see a net of covering being poured out. Father, I thank you. And we worship you now in obedience to your word. We give you the praise and the honor and all of the glory in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Would you stand with me? Before you leave your seats, there are ushers in the front and ushers in the back of the room for your convenience. As a way of dismissal on this Freedom Weekend, I want to share something with you. The 2.5 years of bondage and the chains that we have rattled in Honduras have been broken. I want to see you Thursday because Josiah William Raff and his poppers and his daddy and his mommy will be in this sanctuary Thursday night. Celebrate your day and enjoy your week.